Get from this.
Well, sending my baby left me. Well, I found a new place to dwell. Well, it's down at the end of Lonely Street at Heartbreaker.
To this.
Oh, make me feel so good.
To this. Good evening. I'm Ted Koppel, and this is Nightline.
Walking through a party in the county jail. The prison band was there and they began to wail.
To mark Elvis Presley's birthday earlier this week, we'll take a look tonight at his roots in the blues and the impact of the blues on music around the world today. Our guests.
Every day I have the blues.
The world's best known blues man, B.B. King. And the spectacular young jazz trumpeter, Wynton Marsalis.
This is ABC News Nightline. Reporting from Washington, Ted Koppel.
Somewhere on Earth, there may be a culture in which the sound of the Mississippi Delta blues stirs not a single resonant response. But it's not in Japan or the Soviet Union. There are fans of the blues in Bulgaria and Brazil. And while it is an art form that grew unmistakably from Afro-American roots, the blues crossed the color barrier long before most whites knew what we were listening to. One of those who bridged the gap between white and black America using the blues as his vehicle was that icon of popular music, Elvis Presley. But he's not the focus of this program tonight. He appears as a major supporting character, but the focus is the blues. Here's Jed Duval.
Well, my home's in the Delta.
The home of the blues, they will tell you here, is the Mississippi Delta. That slice of flat land along the river, that is as deep as
now
deep south gets.
I'm leaving Chicago.
Where the soil is rich and the people are mostly poor. Where black people sing and feel the blues.
Now you know I'm leaving here in the morning.
Where the university, not far away, is called Ole Miss, and where blacks had to fight their way onto the campus with the help of federal troops just a generation ago. It was James Meredith who was the first to enroll.
The town of Oxford is an armed camp following riots that accompanied the registration of the first Negro in the university's 118-year history. Nearly 6,000 troops patrol Oxford to maintain order in the greatest crisis the South has faced since the Civil War.
The campus is peaceful these days, integrated to the extent that 6.5% of the students are black. But blacks are represented in another way here at Ole Miss. Their music, the blues, the Delta blues, the Mississippi blues, are saved, preserved, cared for, collected, and nourished in an extraordinary archive on the campus.
Ludella, Ludella.
Its 35,000 records make it not only one of the most important centers for the study of black culture in America, but gems in the stacks are enough to make a record collector's eyes glisten.
And what did we find in this archive? The works of, among many artists, a man named Arthur Big Boy Crudup. He recorded this song in 1946. It may sound familiar to you.
Well, now that's all right, no mama. That's all right for you. That's all right, no mama. Any way you do, but that's all right.
When that recording was made, the war was over, Detroit was building cars again, and this fellow was just 11 years old.
Well, that's all right, no mama. That's all right for you. That's all right.
Elvis, in the manner of many white musicians, clearly had been listening to the blues. isolated case? No, there are a number of Elvis songs that were recorded first by blacks.
You ain't nothing but a hound dog when snooping on my door. You ain't nothing but a hound dog when snooping on my door.
Elvis's music is heavily shaped by the blues. His rhythms, his timing, his beats, his performance on stage, all borrow from the Afro-American dance and music tradition. My feeling is that he and I grew up in the same period, and white Southerners at that time, which was a period of Jim Crow and racial segregation, listened first to black music on radio.
This is your soul man to be with you until I get through. I want you to stand by, don't have no fear, because the soul man is here.
There is a man who watched and listened as the blues went out from the Delta to America and to the world. He is a living link to those days. Early Wright has been playing the blues on the radio in Clarksdale, Mississippi, since Harry Truman was president and the Dodgers were still in Brooklyn. He is one of the few, if not the only, disc jockey ever to have a scholarship named after him. It's at Ole Miss.
If you're in the market for buying a small, medium, or large-sized hog, now is your day to buy it. Get it from the hog farm at Reno Lodge, Mississippi. I got a little things coming up by B.B. King.
Of course, a lot of black people listen to you, but do you figure that some young whites have been listening to you all this time?
Well, to give you the truth, I believe my listeners are 50-50.
50-50.
Right. That's my belief.
Do you believe that maybe a young Elvis Presley was listening to you in the late 40s and learned?
Oh, sure. I believe so.
What makes you think that?
Because I've had some any numbers of white listening, and I was told that Elvis Presley said that he enjoyed my program.
What do you think of musicians, white and black, and some Elvis Presley's one name comes to mind, having taken the music? They just hear a song and they pick up and record it and they become famous.
Well, it's no different from, taking the cotton that somebody raises and doing that, or taking any other product of a people and exploiting it for, you know, personal gain. On the one hand, what that can do is, you know, keep some semblance of what that music was about alive and well.
The music is alive and well, with or without rock and roll. Just look inside the Blue Diamond Lounge in Clarksdale on a Saturday night. You don't have to change much for it to be a Saturday night 40 years ago. The music is loud and driving, and it's the blues, the very core of black American music. This is the way it was when Elvis and Elton John and Paul McCartney and John Lennon and so many others were merely little boys, and this music is a gift to them from these people. A gift to them and to us and to the world. This is Jed Duval for Nightline at the Blue Diamond Lounge on Tallahatchie Street in Clarksdale, Mississippi.
When we come back, we'll only have two of the greatest musicians in the world. We'll talk with jazz trumpeter Wynton Marsalis and B.B. King. Probably the most listened to and certainly the most renowned blues musician in the world today. He's also a major contributor to the Blues Archives at the University of Mississippi, to which he has given his personal memorabilia and his collection of more than 10,000 phonograph records. B.B. King is with us now from San Francisco. And I would like to begin at the very beginning. We're going to try and do, B.B., the impossible on this program, that is to explain the blues. And when we run out of words to explain it, I know there's one way that you can explain it, and that's using your music. I want to run a little piece of video that we have here that was, I believe, recorded also in the Mississippi Delta. And if you can just explain to us what this man here is doing. He's got a broom, he's taking the wire off. You're familiar with what he's doing, aren't you?
Yes, I am. He is now, like most of us, on the back porch, front porch of one of the houses, tenant houses. And he's fixing to, he's starting to make him a guitar, one string guitar. I think most of us that lived in the country and we couldn't afford guitars have did that at one time or another. And funny thing, that usually we would take the wire off a broom because generally that wire seemed to have a pretty good sound to it, pretty close to the sound of a guitar string.
B.B., hold on just a second. Let's listen for a moment. Now, that, I suppose, and you correct me if I'm wrong, is blues music at its most basic. It doesn't get much more basic than unraveling a wire from a broom and banging it up on the porch and playing it. But what is the element of the blues? What is the thing that defines the blues?
Well, that's kind of hard for me to answer. I believe that's sort of like the old saying that beauty lies in the eyes of the beholder. I think it has a lot to do with the guy's feeling. He's telling a story. I wished I'd been as good as he was there. But he's telling a story. He feels what he's doing. And it's kind of like life as we live it today and as we've lived it in the past. And as I believe we live it in the future, because it has to do with people, places, and things, feelings. Most of us feel that if it's love affairs, we always feel that we'll love less than we love. And if it's jobs, if it has to do with the economy, we seem to do worse than everybody else. Seem like everybody else manages a little better than we do. Okay. And we sing about it, and usually we get some relief from it when we do.
Now, those are the words and the emotions that you're expressing. What about the music? Is there something that defines a piece of blues, some particular pattern to it that makes something blues?
That's about the best I can tell you.
Well, that's as eloquent as anything that anyone I've ever had in this program could say. Let me just ask you to hold on one second, because we're going to bring on our other guest, and then we'll talk to the two of you for a while. A French classical musician called him potentially the greatest horn player of all time. In 1984, he became the only person ever to win the Grammy Awards for both the best jazz and the best classical LP in the same year. Wynton Marsalis is with us now from his home in New York City. Wynton, before you talk, maybe you want to reply to what B.B. just had to say on his guitar and do it with your horn.
Well, I mean, B.B. is a master of the blues. I'm not going to embarrass myself by picking up my horn after that.
There is no way you're going to embarrass yourself, and let's put aside the false humility, you know, the false humility, and pick up the horn, would you?
No, that's false, man. B.B. knows that I'm serious. I'm telling the truth. Well, you know, Ted, it's being on with a master of the blues like B.B. King is a very difficult thing, and he's a great blues performer because he's mastered the many different idiomatic nuances of the style. Myself, I'm a young man. I come up in the 1970s. You know, I'm still trying to get to the blues. And the device that I have right here is a plunger. And this is a mute that the early musicians used and the musicians use today. And it was raised to its highest level by the musicians in Duke Ellington's band. And they use this to get certain vocal effects. This will give the regular instrument, the trumpet, the ability to hit different notes. Kind of notes that have a polytonal type of quality, and you can hit more than one note. Like, let's say if I have a D. So see, I can hit 10 or 11 notes with this one device. Let's say if we play this blues.
Let me just say that Marcus Roberts is playing piano for you there, Wynton Marsalis, and we're going to have to take a break. But when we come back, I'm going to ask the three of you, but you, B.B. King, and you, Wynton Marsalis, to try to explain to me how different forms of music, from jazz to swing to rock and roll, all have their roots in the blues. We'll continue in a moment.
Listen to the King! We got something new.
The new Eggwich Muffin Sandwich. Egg, Canadian-style bacon and cheese, just 99 cents.
BK and BB, something new for you.
And for later on, the new King Supreme. More beef than a Big Mac. With saucier sauce. Always flame broiled, never fried.
Every night and day, BB and BK let you have it your way.
Continuing our conversation now with B.B. King in San Francisco and Wynton Marsalis in New York. B.B., let me begin with you. When I said a moment ago the roots of jazz, swing, rock and roll, all find their roots in the blues. You agree?
Yes, I do. I think so. I'm not a jazz player, so I can't really say, but to me, the roots are there, and I seem to believe that the great jazz musicians, as Mr. Marsalis is, he, even in the beginning, I've heard him mention many times his father, and I know his father's a great jazz musician, but from time to time, I hear some of the roots in his playing, and I believe that most of the great musicians, when I listen, I hear a little bit of that root there. That leads me to believe that there is a little bit of blues in all of the Western music.
Wynton, is there any way that you can show us, that you can demonstrate? You truly are one of the great jazz musicians in the world. Can you show us how jazz owes a certain debt to the blues? I mean, where it derives from?
Well, the first thing is that all American music derives from the blues. And most Western music comes out of a church experience. So does the blues. It comes out of our church music. And the thing that makes the blues such a very difficult thing to discuss is that it addresses many different levels of thought at the same time. Like, you have the very basic blues, and you have blueses like the blues that Duke Ellington composed, which are some of the most complex pieces of music ever written, including the entire history of European classical music. So the jazz musicians use the blues. The blues is like a roux in a gumbo. You know, I'm from New Orleans, and we eat a dish called gumbo. And the gumbo, at the bottom of a gumbo, is a flour base. It's called the roux. And the roux is what gives the gumbo its texture and its flavor. Without the roux, you don't have a gumbo. And the roux is the hardest thing to make.
Can you show us what you're talking about?
Well, it's very difficult for me to demonstrate that. I'll show you all this, right? In traditional Western harmony, the tonal keys are the one chord, which is this chord, the four chord, the five chord, and the one chord. All right, now, in church music, when you hear amen, in traditional, this is the traditional European church music coming out of Gregorian chant, when you hear amen, you usually hear the one chord to the four chord, back to the one chord. All right, Jay.
Listening.
All right, now this is where our blues represents an Afro-Americanization of this tradition, because the blues tradition is based on this progression, 1-4-1, to the children. Right. All right, now what we have in a blues progression, we find the blues in the very last section has 5-4-1. Play 5. 5. 4, and then 1. All right, now another thing that makes the blues very difficult to discuss is that a lot of times people think the blues is sad. Well, the blues is not necessarily sad. The blues, it's as such is sad, but the blues as music is joyous. It's affirmation in the face of adversity, and in that way, the blues musicians are themselves heroic. They show courage, elegance under pressure, and when we hear the blues musician playing, stomping the blues, playing, joyously shouting the blues, we don't necessarily always hear a dirge or something sad. We hear the full range of the experiences that one has in life. It's like if you take the blues words like, I'm going to New Orleans, I got gumbo on my mind. I'm going to New Orleans, a po' boy sandwich would be fine. But before I get to New Orleans, I got some shoes to shine. All right, so now what you have is he's thinking about gumbo, and he's thinking about a po' boy sandwich. Now, that's a good joyous. You're going to eat you some gumbo. You're going to eat you a nice, thick, juicy po' boy sandwich. But now, before you get to that gumbo and that po' boy sandwich, you're going to get down there and deal with them shoes.
Hey, you have given me the kind of lead, because we have to shine some shoes here, too, which means selling some products. And when we come back, we're going to get to the po' boy sandwich and the gumbo and a whole lot of other things that you're going to do for us. And I don't know whether you could hear it, Wynton, but B.B. King was playing along with you even while you were giving that little lecture.
Yeah, he was killing
and,
him.
And we want to hear a main course when we come back. We'll continue in just a moment. And continuing our conversation now with B.B. King in San Francisco and Wynton Marsalis in New York. B.B., we've had the appetizer. We want to go to the main course now. Why don't you lead? And if the spirit so moves Wynton, and I kind of have a feeling that it will, and Marcus Roberts, maybe they'll join in, give you a little backup. To tell our audience that what you have just seen and what you've just been listening to is a couple of men who did not know they were going to be playing together tonight, who are in two different cities, who cannot see each other, who didn't know what they were going to be playing, who just did that at my request. And if there is anything about the universality of blues, I think you've just heard it expressed more eloquently than words can do. Gentlemen, if I can ask you to play us out, because that's what we're going to do, you have my profoundest thanks. I love blues before tonight. I love it even more after tonight. B.B. King, thank you. Wynton Marsalis, thank you. Marcus Roberts, thank you all for joining us. Play us out, would you? And I'd just like to warn our affiliates, we're going to be going over a few seconds, and if you want to miss out on this, you dump out. Otherwise, hang in. Thank you.